One day, years of prison had passed already. I was taken out of my cell and brought before an officer of the secret police who had to investigate me. I knew that usually when you are brought there, they will beat you, they will torture you. To my great surprise, on that evening, he was very nice, very polite. He seated me on a comfortable armchair. He had a Bible open before him and said, Mister, they called us bandits, rascals, all kinds of such words. And now at once I hear, Mr. Boomerang, don't be afraid of anything. I will not inquire from you about anything. I wish just to discuss with you something from the Bible. I was very glad. He asked me, do you believe that this word, that this is the word of God, and that it is the truth? Now, I did not explain to him, but I wish to explain to you. Preaching in any language of the world, I can lift this book and say this is the word of God. Now, this book is written by Jews. There is not one line here written by anybody else than by a Jew. But if you wish to say in Hebrew that this is the word of God, you can't, because the Hebrews don't have the word, word. What is word? We throw words around the whole week, to the right and to our left, and so much of these words are babbling. The Jews, instead of words, say davar, and davar means, even in modern Hebrew, which is spoken in Israel, a real thing. Ani noten lecha et advar hazeh. I give you this real thing. After hearing somebody from the people of God speaking to you, if he has spoken to you 5 minutes, after this you are richer than before. He has given you a real thing which you did not have before. And as the word to word does not exist, so the word to speak does not exist. To speak, instead of to speak, they say ledaber, to give a real thing. They don't have the word to say. Instead of to say, they use lesaper, and lesaper means to give a jewel. As often as somebody from the people of God opens his mouth, he's meant to give a jewel. If you have no jewel to give, you don't have a jewel always with you. If you don't have a jewel to give, you have a very easy solution. Keep your mouth shut. Open it only when you have a jewel to give. If this rule would be respected, there would be no quarrels in the family. There would be no divorces. There would be no split between children and parents. There would be no nothing. No divergences in church, no conflict, no nothing. If everybody would speak only when he has a jewel to give. To say in Hebrew means to give a jewel. And they have a third word, which is leomer, and leomer means to lift somebody, to elevate somebody to the highest branch of a tree. When I speak, when I say something, I must elevate you. You should be in a higher sphere than you have been before. And now I could not explain all this to the captain of the Romanian secret police. They were not interested in theology. He asked me, do you believe that this is the word of God, and that it is true? I said that, I answered, I believe that everything in this book is true. So he opened the Bible at the first page and said, here it is written that God created man in his image and in his likeness. Do you believe this to be true? Captain, I told you already that I believe everything in the Bible to be true. So this also, I believe that man is made in the image and likeness of God. Then he opened his drawer and took out from the drawer a small mirror and gave it to me and said, please look into the mirror. I had never been so shocked as before. I had not seen myself in a mirror during years. And what I saw now was a horror. I was considered at that time a very handsome man. Now there exists only one person who still believes that I'm handsome, that's my wife. But at that time there were others also who believed that I'm a handsome man. And what I saw was so monstrous. First of all, surely we were shorn. I was only skin and bones, had dark circles around my eyes, had no teeth in my mouth. The communist said the most perfect dentistry. Pack, pack, you remain without teeth for all your life and without toothache. You're finished with dentists. And I was terribly, terribly ugly. While sitting in prison, not seeing myself in a mirror, I did not know that I would have to be like this. It was something new to me. He enjoyed to see that I'm shocked. And he asked me, Mr. Wurmbrand, you are a man of truth. You are a pastor. You are a Christian. You are meant to say the truth. Would you admit that you are very, very ugly? I said, in my life, I've never seen somebody as ugly as I see that I am now. Well, but you just said that you believe men to be created in the image and likeness of God. You are a man. So you also must be created in the image of likeness and likeness of God. Do you believe this? Yes, sure, I believe. Well, if you are so ugly and you are his likeness, then God must be monstrously ugly. And if he's so terribly ugly, then why do you love him? We all love a pretty child, something, a pretty flower. We love the beautiful things. We don't chase after the ugly things. Why would you sacrifice yourself and why would you honor so and praise somebody who is so terribly ugly? Look in the mirror and you will see how ugly your God is. He is as ugly as you. Now, you can be a doctor in theology, but you are not taught in theology what to reply to such a question. But we have a friend who gives us the idea what to say. And I replied to him, we don't have the word face in Hebrew. And the God who made me in his likeness is also a person with many faces. Where it is written in our Bible, may God shine his face upon you. In Hebrew it is, may God shine his faces upon you. He has one face of utter serenity, quiet, love. He knows he's the King of Kings. He will be the ruler of this world, uncontested. His will be the victory. He spreads around him this quiet, this rest. That is one of the faces of God. He has also another face. He became man in Jesus Christ. And they spat in his face. They kicked him in his face. Tears and blood mingled on his face. He was unwashed in prison in which he was kept the night before. He might have had straw in his hair from the straw mattress on which he slept that night. And then they drove nails into his hands and into his feet. His face must have been marked by the suffering through which he passed. Every physical suffering distorts you. And he did not have only the physical suffering. He had the spiritual suffering. He saw his Holy Mother weeping at the foot of the cross. That must have broken his heart. You could see on his face all this pain. Jesus on the cross was not beautiful, but this was also a face of God. And that was not the only face of Jesus. On the third day he rose, and he was so beautiful and so shining, that the Roman soldiers could not look at him. They fell down. He had another face. So I might be very ugly today, but this my ugly face is also the face of a God who loves me and is taking upon himself all the ugliness of human life and human sin in order to save us. Yes, Captain, I'm ugly, but I'm his, and I have his face. He did not reply, but there was a reply in this, that on that night I was not beaten, which was a very rare thing with that. So the word must have impressed him.